Are you ready? All right, I want to begin today with the subject of electric dipole transitions. Yeah, if you could wait until the end of the hour for this. I want to start today with the subject of electric dipole transitions and the fine structure model of hydrogen. I've outlined for you in very schematic form what the energy levels look like with the notation I explained last time. This is only a model, it's a fine structure model, and it does emit some physics, but it's certainly more accurate than the electrostatic model. In any case, dipole transitions are governed by the matrix elements of the position operator, which is basically the same as the dipole operator. So it's position operator R vector. And it's sandwiched between initial and final states, which in the fine structure model has quantum numbers NLJ and NJ, like this. So we want to have these quantum numbers on both sides. And we want to prime the numbers on one side to indicate an upper state, and then unprime the lower side to indicate a lower state. All the quantum numbers on both sides are different. All right. So we use the figure Eckhart theorem for this. That is an exercise in determining selection rules by using the figure Eckhart theorem. We first notice that the position operator is a T1Q operator. It's a K equals one irreducible tensor operator. This is in Cartesian form, and I won't worry about the Q, but let's just concentrate on the K value. The position operator is, of course, a purely spatial operator. And that means it's a vector operator not only under rotations, purely spatial rotations, or orbital rotations, which are generated by L, but also under total rotations of both orbital and spin degrees of freedom, which are generated by J. And thus you can use the Wigner-Eckhart theorem here twice. If you use it with L, there's a selection rule of the L quantum numbers. It says that the delta L, which is L prime minus L, is the difference between the initial and final L's here, is either equal to 0 or plus or minus 1. This is what comes from the Wigner-Eckhart theorem, and it's just the addition, the rules of addition of angular momentum with L here combined with the 1 there has to be able to, reach L prime from that. However, if you take into account parity, then parity excludes the value delta L equals 0, and that goes out. And then we end up with the dipole selection rules of delta L must equal plus or minus 1. These are the same rules we had when we were talking about the electrostatic model, no change. Now, however, we also have rotations generated by J. These are overall rotations. And we've got J quantum numbers on the two sides. And again, this is an irreducible tensor operator with respect to total rotations. So we get another selection rule that says that delta J is equal to J prime minus J. Is either equal to 0 or plus or minus 1. This is again coming from the Wigner-Eckhart theorem. In the case of L, it's the Wigner-Eckhart theorem plus parity. The parity excludes the delta L equals 0. parity has no effect on delta J equals 0. There is no parity to a given. Parity is not a function of J, it's a function of L. And the result is that delta J equals 0, which is allowed by the Wigner-Eckhart theorem, actually is allowed and can't happen. So there's a slight difference in the L and the J rules. Anyway, if we apply this, what we find is that, for example, in the 2P to the 1S transitions, there's actually two of them can take place. You can go like this. And so the 2P to 1S transition in hydrogen actually appears as a doublet. Same thing happens, by the way, in the 3P to 3S transition with sodium. That's the doublet line of sodium D, doublet sodium D line. It's split by fine structure. Similarly, the 3P to 2S can go like this. The 3S to 2P can go like this. There's again two lines coming down like this. If we look at the 3D to the 2P, the 3D 3 halves can go down to the 2P 1 half, and it can also go down to the 2P 3 halves. However, the 3D 5 halves is only allowed to go down to the 2P 3 halves, because to go to the 2P 1 half would be a delta J of 2, and that's not allowed. So this 3D to 2P transition is actually a triplet and not a quadruplet line. Anyway, these are the allowed transitions, and if you include higher states, you can fill in the diagram like this. Okay, so that's an example of application of the Wigner-Eckhart theorem for a dipole transition selection rules. All right, I'd like to go to new board and start a new topic. The new topic I'd like to address is the Zeeman effect of Fuchimiwa. I'll finish today. Does anyone in fact, as you know, I'm sure you know, involves the response of, of an atom to a, an external magnetic field. And we'll be considering here mainly hydrogen, but also some attention given to alkalis. These are both examples of single electron atoms, which is mainly the, what we want to look at. Before I begin, I want to say something about units and orders of magnitude. It's convenient in this calculation to use atomic units. In fact, atomic units are used a great deal in atomic physics. Atomic units takes the three physical constants which occur in the Schrödinger equation for the hydrogen atom and just sets them equal to one. This is the electron charge, the electron mass, and h-bar are all set equal to one. You can't set any more physical constants equal to one because this takes care of everything. There's only three independent ones you can use, and this is the most that you can set equal to one. The basic idea of atomic units is that it gives you not only units of charge, mass, etc., but also units of distance, time, energy, momentum, all the physical quantities. And what these units are is that they are the basic quantities which appear in the ground state of hydrogen. So, for example, the atomic unit of velocity is the velocity of the electron in the ground state of hydrogen, which is alpha times the speed of light, 1 over 137 c. Give you some idea what goes on with atomic units. If we take the fine structure constant, which is b squared over h bar c, which is 1 over 137, this is dimensionless. And so it has the same value in all units. And we're restricted to atomic units, and the e squared and h bar go away, and what's left over is just 1 over c. And so what we see is that c, the speed of light, is equal to 137 in atomic units. That's its numerical value. This corresponds to the fact that v equals 1, the velocity of the electron in the ground state of the hydrogen atom, is alpha times the speed of light. So the speed of light is 1 over alpha. This is what you get. Another thing to look at is the Bohr magneton. UB is equal to EH bar over 2MC. And if we go to atomic units, the E, the H bar, and the M go away, and it just turns into 1 over 2C, which in view of the result just above is the same thing as alpha over 2. That's the Bohr magneton. And thus, the magnetic moment of the electron, U of which is equal to minus the G factor of the electron times the Bohr magneton UB times the spin divided by H bar. This is puts it in gets its dimensions right. The dimension comes from UV. Well, if we put this in atomic units, the H bar goes away, the UV becomes alpha over 2, and the GE, if we approximate this, and we try to do this upside down, is equal to 2, good approximation, then it cancels the 2 here. And the result is this becomes just simply minus alpha times the spin for the magnetic moment. And thus, finally, the energy of interaction of the magnetic moment with the external magnetic field, which is minus mu dot b, becomes plus alpha times b dotted into the spin s. Okay. So this is some basics of atomic units. Now, in addition to atomic units for distance, velocity, and so on, we also need atomic units for magnetic field because we're going to be doing the Zeeman effect. Let's call the field B naught, which is equal to one atomic unit, and ask what is B naught in terms of Gauss. Well, the answer is obtained by finding the unique magnetic field that can be constructed out of these three physical constants. By dimensional analysis, you can just work it out. Actually, since the magnetic field in Gaussian units has the same dimension as an electric field, it's also the same thing as E naught measured in stat moles per centimeter. And the atomic unit of electric field is easy to see what that is. It's the electric field at the radius of the Bohr radius in the hydrogen atom. And so it's the same thing as the charge of the proton divided by the Bohr radius square. And if you put that all together into basic units, this becomes the mass squared times e to the fifth power divided by h bar to the fourth, I believe. And then converting that into Gauss, it turns into 1.7 times by 10 to the 7th Gauss. So this is the unit of magnetic field in the Gaussian, in atomic units. In ordinary units, it's that much. Now, by way of reference, the strongest magnetic fields that can be created in laboratories under normal circumstances are created by using superconducting magnets. And these get up to about 10 Tesla, which is, roughly speaking, which is the same as about 10 to the 5th Gauss. So by comparison, the largest laboratory magnetic fields are about 10 to the fifth Gauss. And that means that if we're dealing with laboratory magnetic fields, then V over V naught, which is the same thing as the magnetic field measured in atomic units, is less than or comparable to something like 10 to the minus 2. It's a small number. Coincidentally, that's also about the same thing as the fine structure constant alpha. So in atomic units where V0 is equal to 1, the Vs that we'll be dealing with are generally small, less than about 1%. I might add that in astrophysical situations, there are much larger, stronger magnetic fields that arise, all the way up to 10 to the 12th or 10 to the 15th if you want to get speculative Gauss. This is in the near neutron stars or magnetars, I think, in stronger fields. Magnetars are somewhat speculative. But in any case, because of astrophysical applications of that sort, there's been some interest in recent years in the kind of exotic physics that arises with very strong magnetic fields. However, for this discussion of the Zeeman effect, I'm going to assume that our magnetic fields are laboratory fields, and so they're limited by this estimate of order of magnitude here. All right. So that covers the order of magnitude of magnetic fields. Now, the Hamiltonian is, let's do the following. Let's place our single electron atom in a magnetic field which is purely in the z direction. And from this, we can write down a vector potential. The simple vector potential of this one is 1/2 V crossed into R, which if you compute its curl, you'll find that's equal to the V here. The constant V. And so if we put this into the Hamiltonian in ordinary units, then the Hamiltonian is this. It's going to be 1 over 2m. There's the momentum, and it's plus V over C times the vector potential, which is 1/2 V cross R, quantity squared. There's the central point potential for the hydrogen atom or the alkali. And then I'm also going to put in the fine structure terms. Because the fine structure terms, I'll remind you, the fine structure terms in the case of hydrogen are down by a factor of about alpha squared compared to the kinetic energy and the potential energy of the unperturbed system. That's the order of the correction, fine structure corrections. It's basically a V over C squared correction. And in a moment, we'll have to compare the size of the fine structure terms to the Zeeman terms, which will come out from an expansion of this Hamiltonian. Oh, and I forgot one more thing. There's also the minus mu dot b term, which is the interaction of the electron spin with the magnetic field. Now, this is in ordinary units. If I convert this to Gaussian, convert this into atomic units, it becomes 1/2 of p vector. The e goes away. The c becomes 1 over alpha. So let me write it as plus alpha over 2 times b cross r. That whole thing squared. And then the rest of it I've mostly copied, V of R plus H fine structure. And then for mu dot B minus mu dot B, we work that out over here as plus alpha times B dot S. B dot being the spin. So this is what it looks like in atomic units. Allow me to draw your attention at first to the kinetic energy here, which I'll call T. The whole expression here is the kinetic energy. If we expand out the square, we'll get three terms. And let me write this as T1 plus T2 plus T3, just to write out those three terms. And let's look at them over here, look at their orders of magnitude. The T1 is just P squared over 2. The T2 is equal to, there's 2 from a cross term, but there's 2 2s in the denominator. So it turns into alpha over 2 times T dotted into V cross R. But by rearranging the triple product so that it becomes R cross P, we get orbital angular momentum. And this becomes the same thing as alpha over 2 times P dotted into L, the orbital angular momentum. And as far as T3 is concerned, it's just the square of this last term divided by 2. So that's alpha squared over 8 times P cross R, quantity squared. If we put B in the Z direction, as I was suggesting we do here, then this becomes the same thing as alpha squared B squared over 8 times X squared plus Y squared. It's a term that depends only on the position of the electron, and in fact, it sort of looks like a potential. You could throw it in a potential if you wanted to. It's not a central force potential. It's got cylindrical symmetry, not full rotational symmetry. All right. Now, the question is, what is the order of magnitude of the relative order of magnitude of these terms? And just speaking as in terms of order of magnitude, let's look at the ratio of T2 over T1 and just make estimates. We're working here in atomic units. What that means, for example, is that if we're near the ground state of the atom, for which the quantum numbers are small, they're of order unity, then it means that the values of quantities such as energy, momentum, angular momentum are all of order unity, because that's what atomic units do. So in particular, the momentum is of order unity, so the T1 is just of order unity. Now what about T2? There's alpha times V times L. This, of course, is the same thing as alpha over 2, the magnitude of V times LZ. Let's write it that way. And if we assume that LZ is of order unity because it's a quantum number, then the magnitude is basically given by the product of alpha V. So this has the ratio alpha V. Now alpha is 1 over 137, and V, as I just said, is going to be not much more than 1%. So this is very, very roughly something like 10 to the minus 4, is the ratio of those two terms. This is a small perturbation on the momentum here. This 10 to the minus 4 is coincidentally about the same as the relative magnitude of the fine structure term. We'll come back to that later. It's alpha squared is also about 10 to the minus 4. Now, if we take the ratio of T3 over T2, you'll find that this is also of the same order of magnitude as alpha D, which is about 10 to the minus 4. And the result is that of these three terms, they're decreasing in magnitude by a factor of 10 to the minus 4 every time you go down. T3 is then the smallest term of all, and in fact, in the following, I'm going to neglect it, float away. Now, on the other hand, the T2, which as you see here is alpha over 2 V dotted into LZ, is of the same order of magnitude as the alpha V dot S, which is, of course, the same thing as alpha times V times S of Z, if we put the magnetic field in the Z direction. And so the T2 and the nu dot V term, in fact, are of the same order of magnitude. There are only differences between the S and the L by the factor of 2. So throwing away the term T3, then, we can rewrite the Hamiltonian in the following form. The Hamiltonian becomes this. It becomes T squared over 2 plus V of R plus H fine structure plus a term I'll call H Zeeman. H Zeeman is defined this way. It's the sum of T2, which is up there involving V times LZ, and here a V times SZ for the mu dot B. It becomes alpha over 2 times the magnetic field times LZ plus twice S like this. And in fact, since alpha over 2 is the same as the Bohr magneton, it is convenient to write it that way as the Bohr magneton times B, which is certainly okay because I just made the substitution in atomic units. But this is convenient because in ordinary units, mu vb has dimensions of energy, and Hamiltonian does also. So if you just make the LZ and SC dimensionless, then you'll get the right answer. Anyway, it's easy to see this is of energy. Okay, so this is the Hamiltonian we're going to work with. Now, we'll examine this Hamiltonian in several different limits. In the first place, as I mentioned already, really partly by coincidence, it has to do with the maximum value of magnetic fields that are obtainable in laboratories, is that the H Zeeman and H Fine structure are of the same order of magnitude if you use those strong magnetic fields, 100 kilogauss, something like that. So these two being the same order of magnitude, this question about how to treat them, should we take them together or what? By making the magnetic field weak, you can, of course, make the Zeeman term small. You make it as small as you want by making a weak magnetic field. So there is a limit where H Zeeman is much less than H fine structure. That's for weak magnetic fields. On the other hand, if you go to excited states where the quantum numbers suppress the importance of the fine structure but not the importance of HZ, then you can get the other limit where H fine structure is much greater than HZ. This wouldn't apply in the ground state unless you went to magnetic fields. Well, this is wrong. This is HZ much greater than H fine structure. So I'd say it's possible if you go to excited states, This wouldn't be possible in the ground state unless you went to unrealistically large fields from a laboratory standpoint, but still it's a useful limit to consider. So let's take this in various cases. The first case I want to consider is the second one, in which the Zeeman term completely dominates the fine structure term, overwhelms it. And so we'll just set the fine structure term to zero and ignore it. As I say, this is unrealistic for laboratory fields, but it gives us a useful reference case that we can use later on. So, question? Okay. So in that case, in case one then, we'll ignore H fine structure. Let's set up the perturbation problem this way. Take H0 to be P squared over 2 plus V of R. And then take H1 is equal to H Zeeman, which we'll write this way as mu VB times LZ plus twice S. LZ plus twice S sub C. Now this 2, which appears here in front of the spin, is really the G factor of the electron. And it's a way of indicating that the spin of the electron interacts with the magnetic field in a different proportion to its angular momentum than does orbital angular momentum, when the G factor is 1. So L plus 2s is, of course, not the same thing as L plus s, which is the total angular momentum. The vector that interacts with magnetic fields is not the same as J. It's a different vector because of the G factors. All right. So this is our perturbation problem now, and we'll take this as an exercise in perturbation theory of how to analyze it. The unperturbed system is, if we were talking hydrogen, you would have the 2n squared fold degeneracy of the unperturbed eigenstates. Factor 2 comes from the spin. If you were talking about alkalis, you'd have 2 times 2L plus 1 fold degeneracy. But in any case, H0 is degenerate. And so we'll have to think about doing degenerate perturbation theory. So once again, there's a question that we've talked about before of what is a good basis to choose for doing in the unperturbed eigenstates for diagonalizing the matrix of the perturbing Hamiltonian. We're going to try to get by without diagonalizing anything by a clever choice of basis, an intelligent choice. So let's make a list of operators as we did before and a table of them and see which ones of them commute with the perturbing Hamiltonian H1 in order to choose a proper basis. There's really only two choices of bases that are reasonable here. One is the uncoupled basis, which is N, L, M sub L, and M sub S. And the other is the coupled basis, which is N, L, J, and M, J. This is just the same as what we talked about in the case of the fine structure perturbation in the last lecture. But anyway, these are the choices. So let's make a list of operators here. Let's start with Z component of L, and then L squared, and the S component of Z component of S, and S squared, and the Z component of J, and then J squared. Let's make these the operators, because these are the operators that occur here in the two sets of two complete sets of commuting observables. And we want to look at the commutation relations with H Zeeman. Now, by the way, before I get into that, one thing that's fairly obvious is that the full rotational invariance of the unperturbed Hamiltonian has been broken by the introduction of the external magnetic field. H0 commutes with all rotations. H1, however, since the magnetic field is in the z direction, that's why you see LZ and SZ here, this means that the system still commutes with rotations about the z axis, because you can see that the magnetic field is vertical and you've got rotational symmetry. It's a two-dimensional rotation, SO2 symmetry, but the full three-dimensional rotational symmetry has been broken. All right. So anyway, in any case, let's look at commutators. So first of all, does H Zeeman commute with LZ? And the answer is yes, because LZ commutes with itself, and it also commutes with SZ, because LZ and SZ act on different degrees of freedom, so they commute. So the answer is yes. I'll put a check here. What about L squared? Well, L squared commutes with LZ, because that's one of the angular momentum commutation relations, and it commutes with SZ because they act on different degrees of freedom, again. So the answer is a check here also. When you look at SC and S squared, it's the same logic and both of them commute with HC. Now what about JZ? Does JZ commute with this? Geometrically, the answer is clear that it does commute because JZ generates rotations of all the variables orbital and spin about the Z axis. And this Hamiltonian is invariant in rotations about the Z axis. On the other hand, if you want to write out your AC is equal to LZ plus SC, and just look at the commutators here, you'll see that they're all zero, because LZ commutes with itself. So anyway, it does commute with JZ. Now, what about J squared? Turns out it does not commute with J squared. The reason is that J squared is the same thing as L plus S squared as vectors. And this is L squared plus S squared plus twice L dot S. Now, the L squared and S squared do commute with the Zeeman Hamiltonian. That's already here in the table. But the L dot S doesn't, because it involves the X and Y components of L, which don't commute with LZ. And it involves the X and Y components of S, which don't commute with SC. So the result is J squared does not commute. So here's our table of commutators. Now, if we ask which of these two bases is going to be the better basis to choose, it clearly must be the uncoupled basis, because L squared, LZ, and S of Z are all, here they are, L squared, LZ, and S of Z are all checked here, whereas the coupled basis wouldn't work so well because it's got J in it, and J squared is not one of the members. And so what this tells us then is that we should use the uncoupled basis for doing this perturbation population. Let's talk about hydrogen, just to be specific, and let's talk about the unperturbed Hamiltonian does not have the fine structure in it. So let me just talk about 1s, and then we'll have 2s and 2p. And the 1s is two-fold degenerate if you count the spin, the 2s is two-fold degenerate, and the 2p is six-fold degenerate. This is the 2L plus 1 multiplied by 2 for the spin, for a grand total of 2 here and for 8 here of the states. So the n equals 1 and n equals 2 levels are both in the degenerate, but either 2 or, you mentioned 2 or 8. And we're going to move then the matrix elements of this perturbing Hamiltonian inside these degenerate eigenspaces. So here's what we need then. We put H Zeeman in the middle. We're going to have matrix elements that look like this. We're going to have n, l, m sub l, and m sub s on both sides. Now the n has to be the same on both sides because that identifies the unperturbed eigenstate. But the other three indices indicate the basis vectors inside the unperturbed eigenspace. And so in principle, we ought to allow them to be different. However, since HZ commutes with L squared, LZ, and S of Z, in fact, the whole thing is actually diagonal in those matrix elements, and we can remove the primes. And so we only need to compute the diagonal matrix elements. And once again, in doing degenerate perturbation theory, we get away without having to diagonalize any matrices. We just calculate the diagonal entries, and those would be the energy shifts. So the energy shifts in delta E will be equal to this matrix element. Well, it's easy to evaluate that. LZ just turns into a magnetic quantum. LZ and SZ turn into corresponding magnetic quantum numbers. So this becomes mu BB times M sub L plus twice M sub S. And if we write it this way, you see it's actually correct also in ordinary units, but for mu BB is energy and these are dimensionless. All right. So let's look at what this does to the energy levels. First of all, for the 1s, let me take the 1s level. Let's take the 1s, draw it like this. For s level, L is equal to 0, so ML is 0, and s will only be plus or minus a half. So what you get is times 2, you get plus or minus 1 times mu BB. So under the magnetic field, the 1s level splits into 2 that look like this, where the energies are plus 1 and minus 1 measured in units of mu BB relative to the unperturbed energy. The upper state, if I indicate states by their magnetic quantum numbers, ML and MS, the upper state here is 0, 1 half, and the lower state is 0 and minus 1 half. You can see that the splitting is coming entirely from the electron spin, which is logical since there's no overlying momentum. Now, let's go on to the n equals 2 levels. Here there's a 2s and a 2p. As far as the 2s is concerned, it splits in exactly the same way as the 1s and for exactly the same reasons. So you get a plus 1 and a minus 1 here. And this is the quantum numbers 0 and 1/2 and 0 and minus 1/2.
Again, this is the ML and MS quantum numbers. I'm writing here. As far as the 2P state is concerned, it's six-fold degenerate in the unperturbed system. But if you look at the different combinations that you can get by adding up the ML and MS values, you'll find that there are actually five of them. And it fans out like this. And they're measured in multiples of mu BB. They range from minus 2 up to plus 2, like this. What are the states? The maximum one is ML is 1 and MS is a half. The next one down has got ML equals 0 and MS is a half. The next one down has got ML minus 1 and MS is a half. But it also has ML is equal to plus 1 and MS is equal to minus a half. Then down below that we've got 0 and minus a half. And then down below that we've got minus 1 and minus a half. So you see, if you look at the 2p levels alone, the six-fold degeneracy has been resolved into five levels. The center one is still two-fold degenerate, and all the others are now seamless. As far as the 2s level, the two-fold degeneracy is completely resolved. In the case of hydrogen, however, the 2s and 2p levels are degenerate themselves. So the plus 1, plus and minus 1 of the 2s are actually degenerate, with plus and minus 1 of the 2p levels. So there's actually three two-fold degeneracies here, one here between those two, one here in the 2p levels, and another between these two. So some degeneracy remains after the perturbation is turned on. Now, so that's the effect of very strong magnetic fields. So strong that the fine structure can be ignored. Now, next. Let's take the limit in which phase two. Let's take the limit in which the Zeeman term is still much larger than the fine structure term, but we don't neglect the fine structure term. It's not negligible. What we do in this case is we take the previous Hamiltonian H0 plus H1, including the Zeeman term, as a new unperturbed Hamiltonian, and regard H fine structure as a perturbation. So let's do it this way. Let's take H0 as P squared of 2m plus V of R plus H Zeeman. And then let's take H1 is equal to H fine structure. Do a perturbation analysis of this form. This will give us perturbations that are superimposed on top of the energy level diagram that's up in that corner of the board. All right. Now, fine structure term consists of three terms, you know, all the histokinetic energy, Garmin, and spin orbit. And they're all of the same order of magnitude, so to be realistic, you have to include all of them. However, for simplicity, I'm just going to look at the spin orbit term alone, just to save writing. So even though this is not realistic, because this is an exercise you do, let's do this perturbation calculation. Now, in this case, as you can see from those diagrams up there, if you look at n equals 2 levels anyway, there still remains some degeneracy, so we have to think about doing degenerate perturbation theory. However, there's no longer any choice of basis because we had to use the uncoupled basis to get the eigenstates of H0, so the uncoupled basis is all there is. So now what we need to do then is to consider the matrix elements of the spin orbit Hamiltonian in the uncoupled basis. The spin orbit Hamiltonian, if we write it in atomic units, for the case of hydrogen, well, for a single electron atom, write it in atomic units, it looks like this. Did I write it down for you somewhere? I didn't write it down, but I remember it. It's this. It's alpha squared over 2, and then it's 1 over r dvdr, where v is the potential, and then it's l dot s. I mean, the only question is the constants in front. But in atomic units, they turn into alpha squared over 2, showing you quite clearly that the fine structure terms are of order alpha squared compared to the unperturbed Hamiltonian. So we now need to take this and sandwich it between vectors of the uncoupled basis. So in other words, NL, ML, and MS, H spin orbit in the middle, and then NL, ML, and MS. lines on some of these, that is to say, to indicate distinct vectors inside a degenerate eigenspace. If you take the case of hydrogen, there's actually, let's take the n equals 2 levels for just for an example. As I mentioned, there's a twofold degeneracy here. You can see the ML and MS are distinct. There's a twofold degeneracy between there and there. The L values are distinct, and between the lower level here and the minus one level there is also degeneracy. There's actually three twofold degeneracies here. And so it looks like what we need to do is to let the L, the ML, and the MS be different on the two sides. This would give us a matrix, a set of three 2x2 matrices for those degenerate eigenspaces up there. Well, however, right away we can see the spin orbit Hamiltonian commutes with L squared. That's because L squared commutes with L, and it also commutes with S. So the spin orbit Hamiltonian is rotationally invariant in orbital rotation, so in fact it commutes with all functions of orbital angular momentum, including L squared. So that means in particular that this HSO is going to be diagonal in the L quantum number, and I can erase the prime there. Now right away what that means is that there is no coupling between these two degeneracies here or those two up there. The S and P states are decoupled. What about ML and MS? Well, this is LZ and S sub Z. And LZ and S sub Z don't obviously commute with L dot S. And so I'll leave them as primes here for the moment. But the only 2x2 degeneracy that remains is this one right here, in which the ML and MS have these values. So ML is either plus or minus 1, and MS is plus or minus a half. So now at this point, what I'll do is use an identity. It says that L dot S, if you write it in terms of the operators we like, it has this form. It's LZS of Z is the Z component. For the X and Y components, you can write it this way, as 1 half of L plus S minus plus L minus S plus. So let's consider the off-diagonal matrix elements inside this 2x2-dimensional subspace here. You can see that the L values are plus or minus 1, so the delta L is actually equal to 2 for those off-diagonal elements. Now, LZ here is an operator that it's not delta L, it's delta M sub L, it's the magnetic quantum number. That's what this minus 1 and 1 are. It's delta M sub L is equal to 2. So the LZ is an operator that has delta M sub L equals 0. It doesn't change the ML value, whereas L plus and L minus change the ML by plus or minus 1. And so in neither case do we get a delta ML of plus or minus 2, which is needed to connect together those two states. And thus the result is that the off-diagonal matrix elements inside this degenerate eigenspace here in fact vanish, and we once again end up with a diagonal matrix. That means that, again, we just drop the primes here and just consider the diagonal matrix elements. Now, if we do this, then only the LZSZ term will contribute because, as I said, the others give a delta ML plus and minus 1, and also the two sides are not equal. And so this now becomes, as far as the L dot S is concerned, it can be replaced by LZS of Z. And this will, of course, bring out a factor of M sub L times M sub S. And then all that's left over is the expectation value of 1 over R dV dr. And so this whole thing turns into alpha squared over 2 times the expectation value of 1 over R dV dr and times M sub L times M sub S. If you want to specialize the hydrogen, you'll find that this is proportional to 1 over R cubed, and you can actually do it analytically. The expectation value. In any case, this gives us the extra interform, which is due to the spin orbit term, and then that's superimposed on the structure at the board here, so you can see what happens when you turn on the spin orbit term on top of the earlier case in which the Zeeman term was dominant. All right. So that's the second case that I want to consider. Now let's move on to the third case. The third case is the one in which the Zeeman term is much smaller than the defined structure terms. This, of course, is easily achieved by turning down the magnetic field, to have a weak field. In this case, what we'll do is we'll take the unperturbed Hamiltonian to be p squared over 2 plus v of r plus the defined structure terms. And we'll take h1 to be equal to the Zeeman term. Now, of course, this unperturbed Hamiltonian is degenerate. This is the same as the fine structure levels, which I drew at the beginning of the hour. Here they are. Some of the degeneracy is lifted by the fine structure itself, but there's some that remains. The 2s a half and 2p a half, for example, are still degenerate. Let's concentrate on the n equals 2 levels, just to have a case to work with in this problem. So just to copy those levels again, we've got the 2p 1 half, which is degenerate with the 2s a half, which is degenerate with the 2p a half. And then above that is the 2p 3 halves, which, as I explained last time, the splitting here is about 10 gigahertz for hydrogen. And this then is the basic level structure of the n equals 2 levels of the unperturbed system, this H0, which is right here. All right. And so now we need to do, certainly for the j equals a half levels, well, this too is also degenerate. We have two degenerate levels of different degrees of degeneracy, and we need to, again, do degenerate perturbation theory. So we need to diagonalize the perturbing Hamiltonian inside these two degenerate eigenspaces. There's two of them here. What basis to use? There is no choice of basis, because if we restrict our choices to the coupled and uncoupled basis, we can only use the coupled basis, because an uncoupled basis is not an eigenbasis of H0, not including the fine structure terms. We must go to the coupled basis. So the matrix elements in question are going to be this. It's going to be NLJ, MJ, sandwiched around H Zeeman, NLJ, MJ. And the N and the J on the two sides determine the energy level. So those are the same on both sides. But the L and the MJ determine the basis vectors inside the unperturbed eigenspace, and so we allow them to be different from the two sides. Now, however, H Zeeman commutes with LZ. I had a table of it. It's up there. You see, it's at the top of the board. It commutes with LZ. And so, in fact, the matrix elements are diagonal in the L quantum number, and I can remove that prime. Moreover, H Zeeman commutes with JZ, as you can see up there as well. And so I can remove the quantum numbers, I can remove the prime on the MJ. And so once again, we escape from having to diagonalize matrices and doing degenerate perturbation theory. And we only need to calculate the diagonal elements. So the energy shifts then are given by these diagonal elements here. Now, what are those energy shifts? Well, where is my expression for H Zeeman? It's right up here. It involves LZ plus twice SC. Allow me to write this in this form. H Zeeman is equal to mu dV, or magneton times the magnetic field. Let me write it as JZ plus S sub Z. LZ plus SC is JZ, and it leaves it a single factor, a single term of S left over. So that's what this is. This is convenient to do because the states on the two sides are eigenstates of JZ, and this JZ will just bring up the magnetic quantum number M sub J. And so this matrix element then is equal to mu dV times, first of all, M sub J from the JZ. And then what's left over is the matrix element NLJ, MJ sandwiched around S sub Z. This. Okay? Now, it's a last matrix element that requires some techniques. In particular, this is where the projection theorem comes in. The projection theorem is a theorem which is useful for evaluating matrix elements like this, and it arises in quite a few places, quite a few applications.
we'll see it again when we do hyperfine structure, which will be next semester. Here's the, I'll outline for you the derivation of the projection theorem. It starts with an identity, which is due to Dirac. Because let's let A be a vector operator. And then we consider the double commutator of J squared with J squared A. And by using the commutation relations for a vector operator, you can show that this is equal to twice vector of A times J squared plus J squared times vector of A minus 4 A dot into J times J. And I might add, I'm setting H bar equals 1 here. And this is an identity which I won't prove. In fact, I'm going to inflict a homework call on you to do this, to prove this. But I'll show you the consequences of this. Now, allow me to use the general notation, not the notation for the specific problem of the Zeeman effect. Let me use a general notation in which the standard angular momentum basis is gamma Jm in the manner that we've, same notation we've used earlier, general notation for this. If you want to translate this notation into the Zeeman problem, then the gamma gets replaced by n and l. The j just stays j, and the m gets replaced by m sub j. And so these general basis factors turn into those up there for the Zeeman problem. But we might as well treat the problem in generality because we'll use it in another context later as well. So allow me to take both sides of this equation and sandwich it around, sandwich it between gamma j m's. So on the left-hand side, let's take the left-hand side first. Let's write LHS. Let's write this as the commutator of J squared with a vector I'll call X, where X is the same thing as the commutator of J squared with A. So the left-hand side then, so I want to sandwich the left-hand side between basis factors like this. So let's consider gamma J M, and then the commutator of J squared with X, gamma J M, like this. For the Zeeman problem, the only thing we need is where the vectors on both sides are identical. They're the same vector. However, the projection theorem is more general. And in fact, we can allow the gamma and the m on one side to be different than the gamma and the m on the other side. We will, however, require that the j values on the two sides be the same. I know this is another special case. But it's one that occurs. It's the only one we'll need for this course, and it's simpler than the case where the J's are also different. So let's take this case then and look at this matrix element. So this matrix element is easy because it's J squared times X minus X times J squared. And since J squared is being sandwiched around eigenvectors of J with the same eigenvalue on the two sides, each J produces J times J plus 1, and the difference just cancels and gives you 0. So the left-hand side, sandwiched between these two vectors, is 0. And that means the right-hand side, sandwiched between the same two vectors, is 0. Or in other words, it means this, is that gamma prime j m prime on the left, a vector j squared plus j squared times a vector, with gamma j m, that's this term, divided by 2, is equal to twice the same vectors sandwiched around A dot J times J like this. Now on the left hand side, this J squared X on the right, this J squared X on the left, and they both bring out J times J plus 1 with a factor of 2, which will cancel that 2. And all that's left over is the matrix elements of the vector operator A. And so we end up with this, gamma prime j m prime vector operator A, gamma j m, is equal to same vectors, gamma prime j m prime, and then it's a dotted into j times j times gamma j m, and then this is divided by j times j plus 1. This is the projection theorem in the form in which we will use it. Can't believe I'm out of time. okay, well, it's just a few short steps that leads you from here to the land edge G factor. Unfortunately, I don't have time to do it. But the result is that this becomes equal to UVB with a factor of MJ that comes out. There's a 1 here. And then the rest of this gets evaluated by the projection theorem, and it turns into J times J plus 1 minus S times S, plus S times S plus 1 minus L times L plus 1 divided by 2J and J plus 1. And this is the energy shift for the weak Zeeman effect. The quantity in the square brackets is called the Land AG factor. So allow me to make one more comment, which is a standing back from this calculation and looking at what it means from a deeper standpoint. It's actually, at the first sight, it's remarkable that the energy shifts depend on the M sub J, considering the fact that the energy itself has got, so it's because J you see is L plus S, but the spin, the magnetic moments interact with the magnetic field by the vector L plus 2S. So why do the energy levels, energy shifts depend only on the M and J? And the answer to this is that when we're working in a single irreducible subspace of the system, and in any such space, all vector operators are proportional. Particularly, that operator is proportional to that one. This is a result of the Wigner-Eckhart theorem that was the homework problem a couple of weeks ago. And the proportionality factor here has been worked out explicitly using the projection theorem. That's what this Land AG factor is. It gives you that proportionality factor on that invariant subspace. Okay. That's all. So I think.